Warm good morning, everybody, and it's my honor and privilege to welcome each one of you gathered here for this ophthalmic society update on pediatric ophthalmology. And as we know, children are one third of our population and all of our future, in fact. And it's indeed the need of the hour that we spend our quality time for the pediatric ophthalmology. And good ophthalmic care is essential, really, during childhood. As growing children can encounter so many problems, and which can encounter they can encounter during their school time also, and affects the child's capacity to learn and develop vital skills. And I welcome you all for this program. And I also welcome our president, TOS, Dr. V. Karunanidhi sir, secretary TOS, Dr. T. Vimla, treasurer Dr. Moses Rajamani. And this program is sponsored by Ajanta Pharma Limited. And a brief about TOS. TOS, Tamram Ophthalmic Society, was formed and inaugurated on 23rd of August 2015 by the TNO president then, Dr. Prem Raj, registered with the Registrar of Societies in 2016 and affiliated to TNOA on 11th August 2018. And regular TOS TPD programs are being conducted, as all of you are aware, and today is the 20th program. And annual TOSCon conferences are conducted. And Professor Dr. B. Velayadam Glaucoma Oration is held every TOSCon. This pediatric ophthalmology update is the second of its kind. And now actually, as Nirmal said, I remember it's the third one, because the first one was with Dr. Ravindra. Now I remember that this is the third one. And welcome to the scientific session. And without much ado, let me hand over to Dr. V.K. Malathi, who is the assistant professor, ESI Medical College and PGI MSR, to give us the physician's prayer. Over to you, Dr. Malathi.
Thank you, ma'am. Dear Lord, the great physician, I kneel before thee. Since every good and perfect gift must come from thee, I pray, give skill to my hand, clear vision to my mind, kindness and sympathy to my heart. Give me singleness of purpose, strength to lift at least a part of the burden of my suffering fellow men, and a true realization of the privilege that is mine. Take from my heart all guile and worldliness, that with the simple faith of a child, I may rely on thee. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vimla. And if your actions inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and become more, you are a true leader. And we have such a great leader amongst us, and that's Dr. Nirmal, who is a founder, president of Tamram Ophthalmic Society. I invite him to deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Dr. Rachula. So at the outset, I'd thank the president of Tamram Ophthalmic Society, Dr. V. Karunanidhi, for inviting all of us here. Since her is not available, so I take the privilege on his behalf to deliver the welcome address. So respected Professor Pradeep Sharma, welcome to Tamram Ophthalmic Society. Thank you for graciously accepting our invite to deliver this keynote address on an important topic. So sir, as you all know, is a senior most faculty in AIIMS and just retired from his long stint from AIIMS, a 4 decade of service at the premier institute of this country. So I'm happy to welcome on your behalf to Tamram Ophthalmic Society's 20th Continuing Professional Educational Program. I also welcome the other speaker, Dr. Manjula Jayakumar, Senior Consultant in Pediatric Ophthalmology at Agarwal Eye Hospitals. Welcome, Dr. Manjula. And it's a privilege to welcome our own people, Dr. Praveen Krishna, our member and in charge of Pediatric Ophthalmology Department at Radhatri Netralaya, Dr. Ram Prakash, Consultant Pediatric Ophthalmologist at Child Trust Hospital, and Dr. Shruti Nishant, again a Pediatric Ophthalmologist with MNI Hospitals. Also welcome Dr. Roshni Desai, who is a consultant from Mumbai, for accepting our invite to conduct the quiz. I welcome all the delegates for this CPD program update on pediatric ophthalmology on behalf of our office bearers, and all the delegates Thank you for joining on this Sunday morning. I wish you all a grand academic feast. And this is also the right time, like the COVID is picking up, and our not only academic, our safety precautions also should pick up. I hope all of you are vaccinated, because we as doctors have to promote this among our patients. And of course, it may not be the duty of ophthalmologist alone, but it's our social duty to promote. So at least tell all your patients, particularly most of our patients are vulnerable patients. So tell all your patients to get vaccinated, so that we continue to spread the social message and also feel safe at the end to practice. And also have a request to all the office bearers, anything that doesn't grow, stay still. Failure to thrive is not a good sign anywhere, not only in pediatric age group, but also for the society. So my humble request is to improve the membership, focus on this at least during the lockdown period, so that the newbies in and around practicing in and around Tambaram, there are a lot of medical colleges, a lot of new professional joining these medical colleges and also starting practice. So each one should bring one member, so that our present strength of around 80 goes and doubles. So during this pandemic, I would like the pandemic and the exponential increase of membership, rather than the exponential increase of COVID cases and webinars. So till we meet in the next physical meeting, once again, thank you for joining today's program. I thank you, all of you. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Nirmal. And that was a really informative message for us, and take on that we should help the society to grow and have such programs more and more. Doing all things with love, passion, and dedication. And here's our dynamic secretary, Dr. T. Vimla, to deliver the secretary report.
Thank you, ma'am. A very warm good morning and warm welcome to all the delegates. As madam has already introduced, the Tambaram Ophthalmic Society, it is a registered society, which was formally inaugurated on the 23rd of August in the year 2015. Our society was affiliated to the Tamil Nadu Ophthalmic Association in 2018. Next slide, please. So it got affiliated to the Tamil Nadu Ophthalmic Association in 2018 at the annual conference, which was held in Pondicherry. Since its inception, we have been conducting the CPD programs and annual conferences on a very regular basis. So till date, we have had totally 19 CPD programs and 6 annual conferences. So even during the 2020 pandemic, we didn't deter. So we continued our academic activities. There was one physical meet which was held in the month of March, an update on uveitis. And after the lockdown, we continued our academic fest on the virtual platform. Next slide, please, ma'am. So after the physical meet in March, we had two virtual meets, one on retinal diagnostics and one on ocular trauma. And we also conducted our annual conference, the TOSCON 2020, and in the virtual platform, with many speakers from the national and state level. Next slide. The first CPD program for the year 2021 was an update in glaucoma. It was held on 24th Jan of 2021. We had Dr. Devan Thuli, sir, a renowned glaucomatologist from New Delhi, who spoke on target pressure-based management of primary open-angle glaucoma. The other speaker was Dr. Sunita Dubey, another renowned glaucomatologist from Delhi, who spoke on algorithmic management of an angle closure glaucoma. Dr. Satyan Parthasarathy from Coimbatore spoke on interpretation of OCT. Then we had a very lively panel discussion with many renowned glaucomatologists from the state level and national level, who discussed and gave their inputs on common problems encountered in managing. Next slide, please, ma'am. In managing the common problems of glaucoma. So with that, today we are in our 20th TOS CPD program, which will be an update on the pediatric ophthalmology. So with all your continued support and participation, we hope to continue with the same momentum. Thank you.
Let's start our scientific session of the day and update on pediatric ophthalmology. I request Dr. Nirmal Frederick to introduce our keynote speaker of the day, Professor Dr. Pradeep Sharma.
Thank you. Thank you again, and it's my honor and privilege to introduce Professor Pradeep Sharma. He's a retired professor and head, section of pediatric ophthalmology from RP Center, All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Sir did his MD at AIIMS, MBBS and MD from AIIMS, and went on to get MAMS, FAMS and fellowship for advanced training in strabismology from Los Angeles Jules Stein Eye Institute. And for his long dedicated service and a lot of academic honors and awards, to name a few, Colonel Rangachari Gold Medal for the best scientific paper, the top award from the All India Ophthalmological Society, another top award on pediatric ophthalmology of the country, Dr. Atavale Award, again from AOS. And he's a visiting faculty of Orbis, and he also been awarded by the Dr. Rustam Ranji Oration, and so many awards to his clinic for his outstanding service. Can I have the next slide? And that's the numerous awards to his credit. I think it will take a long time to read all of them, but so notable among them are the N.D. Lakhanpal Oration, NAP Lecture by American Association for Pediatric Ophthalmology, Dr. Daljit Singh Oration of Punjab Ophthalmic Society, and Dr. Ishwar Chandra Oration from Vidarbha Ophthalmic Society. You know, recently, sir, delivered the Dr. T.N.C. Vedantam Oration at Chennai. He has over 175 scientific articles in national and international journals. Apart from being a prolific speaker, one thing we have to learn from him is he stays so humble and humility personified, very easy to approach, and a very calm, composed speaker. And it's my honor to introduce her at this TOS meeting. And can I have the next slide? And just to sum up his career, this was a mosaic portrait made by his colleagues and students at AIIMS during his retirement party recently. And that was the sir's emotional reply to his students. So welcome, Pradeep Sharma, sir. It's indeed an honor to have you here. Over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Nirmal, for that emotional welcome, and a pleasure. I think you need to stop sharing so that I can share. Yeah. So it's really a pleasure to be speaking as a keynote speaker in the presence of such interested people, young people of Tambaram Ophthalmic Society. And it's nice to know that you are having this as the third pediatric ophthalmology meet. That is something which we all need to do it for our children. Tomorrow happens to be Holi in North India. So our mission should be adding color to the child's life. Stereopsis is the new goalpost. So my talk, I have labeled it as from amblyopia to stereopsis. It's not A to Z, but A to S. And the new goalpost for ophthalmologists is not just having 20/20 vision or 6/3 vision, but also to have the stereopsis and good fusion. Remember, we are not just treating sight or stereopsis, but restoring binocular vision and stereopsis. The challenges that we have in dealing with children is, first of all, in our own mindsets of ophthalmologists, as the realization of the problem of strabismus and amblyopia. We should remember that the binocularity and stereopsis lost in childhood is permanent if it is not done in time. The loss of vision, amblyopia, also cannot be recovered fully if it is delayed. And add to it, the recognition of strabismus by a child is quite early himself, and it affects his personality. It has been seen that children start discriminating even dolls who have squints. We need to be very careful when we deal with these aspects. God gave us two eyes and they become an asset, whether it is the lower animals who have a large field because of the laterally placed eyes, or the higher up animals which have a frontally placed eyes which gives them stereopsis. How do we see binocularly? It's interesting that the two eyes are generating images which are crossing in the optic chiasma, and then they are being collated in our left and the right occipital cortex. More fine part is that the right eye and the left eye, the dominance columns, are coming together in the layer 4C of the cortex and then synapsing up to give us stereopsis. Just to make the situation a little lighter, I might say, the visual development in the cortex, if we take the social analogy, it is like the two strangers coming together and they develop normal harmonious relationship in relation to each eye. This is similar to having a harmonious marriage between a two couple. On the other hand, there may be a couple in which one dominates much more than the other, and they may have both career-oriented developments on each side, but there is nothing common. They live separately or divorced. The other can be that one of them is having a domination over the other, and that results in a situation in the case of eyes, we will call it amblyopia. One eye is good and the other eye gets amblyopic. What is amblyopia? Amblyopia, in the theoretical sense, is the diminution of vision in one or both eyes, with best refractive correction, no obvious pathology of ocular pathways, but that is all words. Simply put, it is a developmental anomaly of vision. The vision, we are not developed with 6-6 vision at birth. It is developing in two critical phases. From 0 to 9 months, it's a sharp rise in the visual acuity of a child, and then gradually up to 6 years of age. So vision is it can be equated to a language. And as we all know, we learn our languages best in childhood. So if I was born in Tamil Nadu, like you all, I would be speaking fluently Tamil. But if I am posted now in Tamil Nadu, I will still get to learn Tamil, but it will be difficult. Same way, the vision can be learned at any age, but it is much more difficult after 5 years of age. So the paradise of vision which can be lost results in amblyopia, and the causes can be either a stimulus deprivation amblyopia, which may be because of high uncorrected refractive errors, or a media opacity in the form of cataract or vitreous hemorrhage or any other problem. Or it may be an unequal uncorrected refractive errors in the two eyes, an isometropic amblyopia. Even if it is corrected and if there is a large difference, it leads to an isoconia, which again gives rise to an amblyopia. Or it may be a strabismic amblyopia because of the squint between the two eyes, or an nystagmus. And of course, there are organic causes which can also lead to amblyopia. A story of two kids. There is a type A personality kid who wants to be very aggressive. He starts seeing clearly in spite of his uncorrected refractive error. So he accommodates. And if he accommodates, he will have an accommodative esotropia, provided he doesn't have good fusional divergence. On the other hand, there may be another personality of child, the lazy kind, like many of us, who may not like to accommodate, and they will just have a bilateral ametropic amblyopia. The moral of the story is, on either side, there is amblyopia. On one side, it may be a strabismic amblyopia, and on the other side, an uncorrected refractive error will give rise to a bilateral ametropic amblyopia. And amblyopia will preclude the fitness of the person in future. So whether it is any job like a pilot or a train or a driver, or even in the surgeon. Nowadays, we have the 3D vision requirement, which is not much more obvious with the heads up surgery. Earlier also, we needed to do through the microscope. And a study which we had done on the simulator for our residents, we found that if we induced an isometropia in one of the eyes, their performance, both on the stereopsis measurement as well as the simulator task, fell down from 97-98% to almost like 55%. We need to be aware of this problem and assess the infant early. How can we assess the child early? It may be with a simple Bruckner's fundus reflex, which is like a photo screening method. This is used, and we are just shining the ophthalmoscope at 1 meter distance with the larger aperture and see the reflex. You'll find that there will be a much more brighter reflex in a squinting eye. even the refractive errors are known to give a different reflex between the two eyes. The other simple thing can be a fixation preference. Even in the presence of a strabismus, the child, if you cover the squinting eye, he doesn't mind so much. But the moment you cover his good eye, he will revolt. And this indirectly tells us that the left eye has got poor vision. There are vision screening guidelines by the American Academy of Ophthalmology and the American Academy of Pediatrics, which have given age-wise screening tests which can be done. So all of us are, I think, aware of this, and we should be following this to make sure that the children are rehabilitated in time. If you have the ability to assess the vision, and we did this assessment of vision by Taylor Equity Cards way back in 2003, it was published in our Indian population. Just to tell you that a normal child at 11 months of age just has about 6/24 vision. And if there is a refractive error, which is significant, it may drop to 6/72. If there is a strabismus, it may drop to 6/200. And if there is a media opacity, it may drop much more drastically. Older children, 1 to 3 years, you may assess by Cardiff Equity Cards. And more recently, we had presented in American Academy of Ophthalmology in Chicago, a digital automated application of DigiTAC using the gaze tracking on the laptop of the camera and using a software, a deep convoluted neural networks, which can assess. And this was how it works, the algorithm. It can digitally assess the visual acuity of a child. Periopsis, you need to see it differently. And there are different tests, but I would not like to go into details of these. The distance stereoacuity tests are in the form of distance Randot stereo test or the Frisbee-Davis distance. And very few centers in our country would have these. But we would recommend each and every pediatric ophthalmologist to have at least one near stereoacuity test. And these are in the form of Titmus Fly, the Randot stereo test, or the Lang stereo test. But the one which is my personal preference and recommendation is the TNO, using the red and green glasses to dissociate. Out of that, a bedside test which you all can do with a child, just play with him and ask him to touch this pencil tip with the one pencil which he's holding in his dominant hand. And this is a task which even us cannot do with one eye covered. So this is a very good test to detect the loss of stereopsis or binocular vision. This is a story which I usually like to share in my talks. A child born at birth with straight eyes starts turning in at around 3 months of age. And his father, he was a lucky child to be born in the family of Kenneth Wright. So his father, Dr. Kenneth Wright, detected it and he gave him glasses. At 6 months of age, seeing the Bruckner's reflex, you can see the left is showing you a much brighter reflex. So there is a residual esotropia in spite of glasses. And this was the non-accommodative esotropia. So the surgery was done at 6 months of age to straighten his eyes, to give good stereopsis, which he is now proud to have. And this could be the story of each and every child in our country too. So the critical periods to remember for treatment is the simple rule of fours and sixes. For congenital cataracts, we all know that we need to deliver ourselves services by about 4 to 6 weeks. For infantile esotropia, detected by 6 months and treated by the first year of life. And similarly, any other problem like intermittent exotropia, nystagmus or refractive error needs to be picked up by 4 to 6 years and treated by that time. Simple things like rehabilitation. Now you may have done a wonderful cataract surgery, but if you have not rehabilitated the child either in the form of the glasses or IOLs or a contact lens, it would lead to amblyopia. And it has been seen in the ATS study that even glasses alone for 1 month given, it gives a 2+ line improvement in 77% of anisometropic amblyopes. What are the modalities of treatment of amblyopia? The first and foremost thing is amelioration of the amblyopogenic factor, a proper visual rehabilitation in the form of optical correction. Second would be occlusion, and we'll talk about this more detail. The third is penalization in the form of atropine or overcorrected or undercorrected glasses. CAM vision stimulation, pleoptics, red filter treatment are treatment which we do not anymore recommend. Active vision therapy is a corroborative thing which we'll be talking about, and then medical treatment. Coming to occlusion schedule, it's a full-time versus part-time schedule that we are talking about. It's about 200 years old, occlusion therapy. And we know that the dominant eye is patched, and it's the age-dependent alternation is one school of thought that we may occlude the good eye for 2:1 for a 2-year-old child, and 3, 4, 5, 6, accordingly 3:1, 4:1. That means the dominant eye is patched for the number of age equivalent days in a week. On the other hand, there is another schedule program, which is now more popular, has been popularized by the ATS or the PEDIG studies, is the part-time occlusion, in which the dominant eye is patched for 6 waking hours and for the more severe type of amblyopes, and for the milder amblyope, just 2 hours daily basis. And these are monitored fortnightly in infancy and monthly later for an older child. It's important to remember, it's a number of occlusion hours. And the study by Stewart, in the Mota study, has shown that 120 occlusion hours is almost equivalent to 1 logMAR visual acuity improvement. So part-time occlusion works, but it will be little slower than a full-time occlusion. Occlusion can be given by opticludes or micropore tapes, depending upon the economic ability of the child and the family. These are the results or summary of the PEDIG studies, which have shown the ATS1, ATS2 and all. And from this, as I said, we have learned that part-time occlusion also works, although a bit slower, but we can use it for better compliance. Now, another take home is that penalization in the form of atropine also works as much as occlusion. Again, a bit slower than occlusion, but it can be used in children who are not accepting occlusion. The point to remember is there is a possibility of recurrence of amblyopia. There can be a loss of 2 lines of visual acuity in 21 or 25% children, and this occurs mostly within the 3 months. It may be more than 3 times if stopped suddenly. So if you have a full-time occlusion, suddenly stop, it will be likely recurrence of amblyopia within 3 months' time. Lesser after 2 hours of patching. So what we learn is that we need to taper the occlusion once we have achieved full correction in the form of maintenance occlusion till about 9 years of age. What have we learned with the changing times? The ancient cat was running after the mouse, but nowadays, again, we are all the cats running after the digital mouses. So have we changed? Yes, there are some changes. Pleioptics, in the quiz, many a times the quiz masters like Dr. Roshni may sometimes be asking you about these antique instruments that are there. We usually are not going to be using these instruments at all. Acupuncture for amblyopia, yes, there is an interesting study published by Dennis Lam group in ophthalmology, archives of ophthalmology, and they have shown that acupuncture also works, but to my mind, it's too many pricks for too little gain. So I would rather not recommend acupuncture. Active vision exercises are definitely something which is very helpful. There can be 3 different kinds of intervention: a monoocular perceptual learning, or a monoocular video game play, and a dichoptic perceptual learning of video game plays. Active vision exercises in addition to occlusion has been very helpful, and we have published ourselves some studies, as well as several authors have shown that active vision exercises will add on to the time of improvement in cases of amblyopia. But the new paradigm shift which is happening in the treatment of amblyopia is the binocular vision stimulation. We are moving from iPads to iPads, the digital pads, and games like Tetris or the other games the child may like to play can be given to improve the visual acuity. One study done by our group had been presented in San Diego APOS in 2019, and it showed that in anisometropic amblyopes, the binocular video game exercises for 1 hour daily for 1 month worked as good as occlusion. But the better part was that the stereo acuity was better in the binocular video games group versus the occlusion group. Remember, even adults are likely to be suppressed having amblyopia. And do we have any hope for them? Yes. Nowadays, we know that the novel video games therapy in even adults can offer some hope in the improvement of amblyopia. What is the basic thing? You remember, it's anti-suppression versus binocular stimulation that we are talking about. Earlier, we have been using synoptophore, keroscopes, stereoscopes, home exercises with stereograms. Now they are coming in a new avatar in the form of digital video games or red-green goggles with the VTS4, Oculus, or the Binox. All these are the newer avatars of the binocular stimulation, which was being done by synoptophore or keroscopes. So these are available at many centers, and they do help in improving the visual acuity of children. I would just like to share a video. So you can see that we are basically breaking the two scenes for the weak eye and a strong eye, and going to blur the vision of the strong eye so that he can see better to match the poorer vision of the weak eye, so that both can be put at par and they can learn to work together. The new paradigm that we are talking about. Another dimension of the paradigm being lost is the misalignment in the form of strabismus. And we all know that just like in the zodiac signs, we have the 9 planets disturbing the 12 houses. With a little variation, we have the 12 extraocular muscles acting like sinister planets and disturbing the harmony in the 9 houses. So we need to give a proper correction by simple rule of OCIP, observe, confirm, infer, plan, and execute, so that each child in the childhood itself can be straightened. There may be pseudo strabismus, which you have to be aware of, and you need to correct them with the proper correction, not only for distance, but also for near, as we can see that there may be accommodative convergence excess, and you need to regularly monitor the refractive error for each and every child as it keeps changing with age. But mind you, it is not just early surgery, but early realignment, which is the goal for us to restore the stereopsis. And not only in one position, but in all the working gazes, like in this child who has ortho in primary position, but on looking down, there is an eso. On looking up, she has an exo. This was a pure V pattern because of a bilateral inferior oblique overaction. So once we know this, we need to correct the inferior obliques and she can be straightened not only in the primary position maintained, but also in the up and down gazes. In adults also, it's a timely realignment which can ensure binocular vision, as it has been shown by Stager's group that strabismus lasting for more than 12 months, even in adults, can be susceptible to the binocular vision loss. So even these adults need to be aligned in time, and by various methods, this is possible for each and every person, that we can ensure the alignment back so that they can have the normal stereopsis. On the same tone, I would like to say even nystagmus can be treated with surgically by simple methods like the augmented Anderson's procedure that we have published in 2006 to restore the head posture and maintain the alignment of the eyes in these children to give them better visual acuity. So we all would like to be a squintellectual, restore the alignment of the eyes in time. And the secret is to catch them early and to have a good compliance ensured by talking to the child and to the parents. Proper plan of treatment and monitoring is to be done. And we need to be guarding against a regression by proper maintenance and tapering. Binocular approach with the help of dioptrics improves amblyopia and also the stereopsis. Remember, we are not just treating sight or strabismus, but we are restoring binocular vision and stereopsis. I would like to thank you all for giving me this chance to speak about my mission, that is the spreading sight and happiness for kids the world across, maintaining the stereopsis and restoring the loss, which I would like all of you to join and make it a mass movement for the betterment of our children. Thank you all.
Very much, sir. It was a very wonderful presentation and a lot of important points that you have highlighted in this talk today on amblyopia. And next, we would like to host some questions. Dr. Shruti, can you just take over this session for an interaction with the sir?
Yes, madam. Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful lecture. I think the pursuit of stereopsis is a trademark presentation of Pradeep sir, which we enjoy listening to every time. And I remember the NAPS lecture, which is something unforgettable. He was the first Asian to present the NAPS lecture. And I think it was a big honor for all Indians, especially pediatric ophthalmologists, for such a big platform in the APOS committee. So, sir,
Thanks.
Yes, sir. So actually, there are a few things which I was we would like to ask. So the first thing is, in infantile ESO, you said the before 1 year is when you would prefer to operate these kids. What do you think is the role of Botox in these kids? Like, do you prefer to use them or do you prefer to operate directly, sir?
Yeah, Botox has been used, as you all know, by Dr. Keith McNear. It was started by Alan Scott and his co-fellow, Dr. Keith McNear. And I was lucky in 2001, I spent 2 months with Dr. Keith McNear to see his results. They are all published in JPOS also. If you see between the lines, you'll find all the cases require at least 2 or 3 times of injection. So that means each time you need to give them an anesthesia. So on the other hand, the surgical results are much better. 80 to 90% of our cases are corrected by one single general anesthesia based surgery. So I would recommend surgery better than Botox. Other thing which was mentioned by Dr. Keith McNear was that all the cases which were successful had to be having a consecutive exotropia in the first 2 or 3 months. Okay, even exotropia is not a good thing to have in a childhood. So why should we be subjecting children to an exotropia for 2-3 months to gain a later esotropia that too again may require another or third re-injection of Botox? So personally, I feel Botox is not a good thing for infantile esotropia correction. It may be still considered for adults when we want short-term realignment, which is required, like in paralytic strabismus.
Thank you so much. In terms of intermittent exotropia, I think we all feel that it is that one unpredictable child in the family kind of a thing. It never responds in predictable fashion, and invariably, whatever we do, it ends up coming back again. So what is your opinion, sir? Any tips and tricks or what do you feel would help in better alignment or better predictors for poorer post-op outcomes?
I think that's a very nice question, Shruti, you have asked. I think you, being a pediatric ophthalmologist, know the problems of managing intermittent exotropia very well. It is true that we cannot always guarantee 100% correction, but we do have a goal that what we do in intermittent exotropes up to 4 years or 5 years of age, we will still correct them if it's a manifest exotropia. Now, first thing is it really intermittent or getting manifest more than 50% of the time? So this can be assessed by simple observation, ask the parents' history. But many a times I get to know from the working mothers that I hardly spend time with the child so much at home, I cannot give you this answer. So then the other thing which comes to our handy thing is the stereopsis. If you can assess the stereopsis of a child at 3 or 4 years of age, he can easily play with you on the stereo charts. And you can see if the stereopsis is falling, it would be definitely an indication for early surgery. Now, when you operate in a child less than 7 years of age, I would recommend doing a little undercorrection. We don't mind having a little exo, which may be fused, rather than having a consecutive ESO, which will be a detriment to an binocular vision therapy. And you can counsel the parents. If need be, we will do a second surgery after the child is old. But in the meantime, we just need to ensure that the intermittent exotropia remains intermittent as exophoric, and we can maintain the binocular vision.
And I do find that stereopsis is one of the most reliable parameters I also go by before I decide for surgery. And I think that's a very important point. And I know that you have a very special interest in nystagmus surgeries as well, sir. So just a simple question for all the general ophthalmologists. We do know a lot of procedures are available for nystagmus surgery. So like you were mentioning, the augmented Andersen's works very well to correct head postures. Would you add a tenotomy and reattachment as well? Do you think that improves the control, sir?
I think nystagmus is an interesting subject for all ophthalmologists. First of all, I would like to make people aware that many children are not operated because of nystagmus, considering that they may not have good results. Nystagmus, if there is an eccentric null position, these are amenable to surgery. What we are basically achieving is correcting the eccentric null by shifting it to the primary position and giving him a head posture free straight look. But the challenge here is to maintain the ortho, because the eyes are not having any inherent ESO or exo. You need to maintain the ortho. So you need to do a calibrated surgery on the muscles. So when we are working on the yoke muscles, either we follow the Kestenbaum's modified approach But what I have found is for up to 30 degrees of head posture, augmented Anderson's works very well. So just handling one muscle in each eye, you can correct a 30 degrees head posture and give him the correction. If it is more than 30 degrees, that means 40 degrees and above, I usually add the resection of the opposite muscle. So then it becomes four muscles, four yoke muscles which are working, two as augmented Anderson's, and the opposite muscles are resected 6 millimeters or 9 millimeters, depending upon medial or lateral rectus. This corrects up to about 45 to 650, 60 degrees of head posture. Now coming to your other question of just doing a disinsertion tenotomy and reinsertion, that is the Hertel-Deloso procedure. It's a very fancy procedure which has been talked about two great people who have worked very much in nystagmus. We did do a study when we were in RP Center and Ames. We found that it works for 3 months only. Then the nystagmus creeps back. So it's not worth doing it as a procedure. So we may at best use it for people who have no eccentric null. People who are very desirous for having some improvement and you have no eccentric null, you can't do an augmented Anderson's procedure, then you can do a four muscle supramaximal recession, that is post equatorial recessions of all the four horizontal recti, or you can do Hertel-Deloso procedure. But still, I would prefer the four supramaximal recession to Hertel-Deloso procedure to give a better visual acuity in these children.
The other question was about now this entire year of pandemic, we've been having a lot of online classes and all that. And suddenly we seem to be seeing a lot of acute comitant esotropias coming up in kids. Have you had similar experiences? I mean, we do have this entity, ASE, but suddenly I do find a lot of acute comitant coming up in children, esotropia especially. So any comments on that, sir?
Yeah, Shruti, that's right. I think in addition to the pandemic of corona, we are having a pandemic of esotropias also coming up, which are these acute esotropia. And unfortunately, because of the technology being overused. So you are right. We do get many children who would be having sudden esotropias developing. So what you would like to do in first is that see these children, they would be having a near point of accommodation because of an overuse of accommodation spasm. So first thing is look for that near point of accommodation. Do a full cycloplegic refraction. Don't compromise by using tropicamide. It would be better in the children to use either hometropine and still better atropine in children who are having a problem with hometropine also. So find out the maximal cycloplegia free, accommodative free hypermetropia and correct it. If need be, you may have to give atropine for 2-3 weeks along with the bifocal glasses for these to break that cycle of accommodation spasm. Some of them even may require some neurological treatment because they get into a sort of that spasm. And there is a very nice article by Linda Dagi on this condition, which was talked about as a neurogenic esotropia. This is there. Another thing which can be used and has been used by some people is Botox. I haven't used personally Botox in these children, but it may be a thing to break the esotropic cycle and put them back onto the tracks. That's another thing. But last resort would be, of course, doing a surgery for those cases which are having it for more than 6 months.
Do progress and have it for a slightly prolonged period. So then I think in those cases, we might have to operate on. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your inputs and all these.
Pleasure, Shruti. And it's really a pleasure to talk to all of you. And on this Tambram, I really give my best wishes for such nicely organized webinars, Dr. Nirmal and the entire team of Tambram Ophthalmic Society. So happy Holi from to all of you, and best wishes to Tambram Ophthalmic Society. Namaskar, vanakkam.
Thank you, sir. And hope you are on time for your family's lunch.
Yeah, not lunch, but the chores. Yeah. Now I have to attend my another boss here. That's only one day.
Right. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay.
Thank you very much, sir, once again for sharing that really good knowledge to all of us.